This is Teflon tape. I've mentioned it in a few videos. I've shown people at a few Boston shows now that you can pretty much fix any seal with it. On the Ahab, if you email one of the retailers that you were fooling with this seal, or you were fooling with this seal and you broke it, and that the pen is not operable, and that you're up the creek, and you needed the pen to work the next day or the next hour, this was about 22 cents. Some stores might charge as much as a dollar, but this would fix innumerable pens. Many vintage repair people have been using this successfully since it was developed, and it's any pen with a seal. The Charlie, you can put it in the threads and in the O-ring groove. 1 to 2 turns, and this thing is as tight as any ship's hull. And 1 to 2 turns here, and this filler unit is sealed. A few turns around until you build it up sufficiently to touch the sides of the filler wall, and you can even replace the filler seal. So hopefully we won't have as much panic out there. This goes for virtually all of the vintage pens that could be disassembled. And the vintage pens, the designers took the time to make sure everything could be disassembled with ease, that nothing was glued, that nothing was fused, and that you could get to all the parts that might fail, so that the pen had a chance long after the maker went out of business or died or something happened, or you were in a different country and couldn't get parts, you could still maintain your fountain pen for many, many years. It's meant as a tool. It's not meant as something that's some specialty limited edition that you're only going to have those particular parts or else. This, as you might have seen, is the Noodler's brush pen. The Ahab brush is different from the Conrad brush. The Conrad brush is a Japanese style brush. It's for very fine detailed writing. Most people use it for highlighting. I know you use Firefly or You're the Golden Pig and use it to highlight texts that you need a colleague to review or read. This is more for artistic use. The Chinese brush is much bigger. You'll notice there is no ebonite in this mechanism because the capillary flow of a brush predates ebonite, and it's quite sufficient. It's pretty much the only thing that can equal ebonite for capillary flow in a large variety of inks is the brush. It can deal with hundreds of different kinds of inks. This is threaded. The section's threaded on the inside, it's threaded on the outside for the barrel, and it's threaded for the filler unit. All of this can be disassembled. The breather tube can be removed by pushing it forward. It's built as a trumpet, as a little trumpet there. And that hole there is your air ink interchange. Notice these are flat toothpicks. Reason it has to be flat, it's the only thing that can get into that tight fit. See? You slide that in, and you pop out the brush, and this brush can now be replaced when the time comes, or if you've used a particular ink and you want to keep it separate from other inks, and that brush has gained a certain character, or you trimmed the brush in a certain way that you want it to be maintained that way. To reinstall, you'll note that there are small catch berms And then there's a wall in the front. And the brush is designed to hit the wall and be retained by the berms. So you wet the brush a little bit to make it nice and pointed. And then take the flat toothpick and push the edge over the berms until you can't push it anymore. You literally will not be able to push it anymore. And you take the breather tube. You'll note how it will push right up because it's semi-flexible. And you thread it in till it's flat here. It's nice and flush. Push the filler unit out. You'll note your air ink interchange, and the reason the filler works is that hole in the filler rod slides in like that. So there's a threaded unit. There are your threads. Engage the threads. It's next to impossible to cross thread it, but I wouldn't put it past some people to cross thread, so be careful. Put the breather tube into the fill unit. And you've reassembled your pen and disassembled your pen. That's how easy it is to replace your brush. You'll notice at certain art supply stores, the classic Chinese form brush, which we've been using for the Ebonite feed, Noodler's brush pen, which in your instructions, you can get three brushes out of one of these for the Ebonite feed, a Noodler's brush pen. This uses an entire brush. There's no way around it. It's designed for it. It's obviously for Chinese-style calligraphy and not Japanese. What makes it also unique in my mind, not only does it fight disposability and planned obsolescence, because you can maintain this for quite a while, it also, being refillable, you should note that some of those brush pens are not refillable. They're quite expensive when you factor in that their average fill is 1/50th of a Noodler's bottle. Some of the roller balls and art pens, it's 50 of them fit in one of these bottles. If you're paying $3 each, that's $150 is not a bargain anymore. The unique thing about this design is that it can deal with the first ink that Confucius used. Why would that be important? Because before there was paper, there were bamboo strips. Paper was developed by the Chinese, and there was an evolution at the time of Confucius from what were, in essence, charcoal inks. The step from writing in front of students with charcoal sticks on rocks, on walls, to demonstrate a lesson, to demonstrate a concept, to putting ink on bamboo strips that then, in the first instance, made a person immortal. This is a stainless steel bearing. This is a jeweler's media. You could also get this from other sources. This is another one that works. This is a bismuth non-toxic shot number 2. They both pretty much the same size. Put it ahead of the breather tube. And you'll notice it becomes an agitator. Why would agitation matter? Confucius started out with what were basically bits of charcoal. This is a piece of vine charcoal. And I believe it is like the kind that Confucius used. And it's been right under the nose of many Americans since around the time of the Civil War. He started out giving his lessons by taking a piece of charcoal and writing his notations on a wall or on stones. He didn't have paper. Confucius had to write on bamboo. And charcoal, you can get charcoal vine to write on bamboo, but he found, and others like him found, that a better delivery system was by grinding up the charcoal and running it through a brush. I've never had a fountain pen that can use the first inks that were, in essence, charcoal inks. Charcoal inks will immediately clog virtually any feed. They're extraordinarily thick. But they don't clog a brush, particularly one like this one. It has a pretty big hole straight through that enables even particulate matter to get through. And through the design of this agitator, it is able to function with what is, in essence, the first ink that wrote and made the first author that arguably is one of the most immortal men in terms of the time that we have known about him because of the words he got down on bamboo. He made himself immortal, and he did it by making charcoal out of this particular vine. As a side note, one of the reasons for researching any of this and investigating the early charcoal inks was a compliment Noodler's ink was paid by a couple of Confucian scholars, one of whom was related to him distantly. They believed Noodler's black would have not only pleased him, but that it would have exceeded the best examination ink for what was then the most vital aspect of Chinese governance and Chinese civilization, the exam system, studying and reviewing and being able to recite the Confucian Analects. They considered it the best, and I've always thought of that as the highest compliment that the Noodler's ink products have ever received. And I thought of doing a comparison using bamboo between, now that there is a pen that can write with the first ink Confucius used, between Noodler's black and what in essence, you can hear there's an agitator in the bottle. This is this Asiatic bittersweet, which it grows in Massachusetts. In fact, it's considered a pest in multiple states. It's been with us since the 1860s. Here's the eastern region of China where Confucius taught his disciples And you'll see that most of where Confucius taught, where his students, where his disciples resided, was north of the Yangtze River. And in this region, biologically, it has an abundance of this particular vine. This is where this vine originated. It was brought over as decorations of whale ships, and the China trade of the 1860s brought it to the eastern United States. And you can see eastern China in terms of deciduous forests, in terms of its flora and fauna, it is biologically similar to the eastern United States. These states actually have restrictions on the trade in this particular vine. It is considered that much of an invasive species, that much of a problem. This is a survey that shows what counties and areas where it is completely dominant. And you can see Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New Hampshire. We have it everywhere. And some of you, artists in particular, I've seen you buy vine charcoal. Now you can see it's very bold. You can't really get fine lines, but if you're working on a big canvas, you wouldn't really care. People work with large pieces of charcoal. They have for ages, but they pay money for it. And this is the classic charcoal. This is the original. This is the one that started calligraphy, and it's surrounding us. The vines can be cut off the side of your local highway or all over the place. They look like this. The older vines look like this. And it's as simple as having a wood stove or even a cookout. Here's a coffee can. Make one cut there, one cut there. Take another coffee can, fill it with the vines until it's crammed. Take the coffee can that's cut, fold the edges over so that your diameter is now more narrow than the receiving diameter of the other coffee can. And this is what happens. It's combined. And with an awl, you can punch a hole. In both sides, and then it becomes as easy as screwing them together. You put that in a stove. And this is what you get. It looks fairly ugly. Ben, this is your yield. All of it becomes the same vine charcoal that Confucius would have taught his students with. And it should not have cost you anything. And I can tell you that there are biologists out there who would dream of seeing every American cut these vines, turn them into charcoal, and use it for artistic purposes. Because it is very difficult to find a use for this plant. It's one of those invasive species that a lot of people hate. And to find out that none other than Confucius used this vine in his early days for the first ink was quite thrilling. And I had to share it with you, and I had to share the methodology and how to make it, and how easily it's made. And to demonstrate the on the classic ink, you can see this bamboo actually grows in Massachusetts as well. It's tough stuff. These actually made the first books. They were bound together. And they are literally the reason Confucius became immortal. The Chinese characters would be written vertically, and this would be a line of text. The ink, either the ancient charcoal ink or the modern Noodler's Black. Will have more staying power. Yes, I'm just going to put a bead of the charcoal ink As you can see, it's designed to flow and make a very, very wet brush line. This is much wetter. Much wetter than the Conrad brush. And it has that one quality that I love in any pen that we produce called fun. It's just fun. It gets me feeling like I'm a kid again in art class. And the teacher just told us to draw anything we want. The ultimate freedom upon the page. The ink, the charcoal ink from long, long ago has dried on the bamboo strip and we'll try the rub test again. It definitely gets on the thumb, though. But it did penetrate the bamboo more. So perhaps the old books are shiny because they may be lacquered over the ink. And that's why it's shiny. They don't let anybody touch those fragments anymore. The best you can get is a high-resolution photograph. Can see how the scholars liked Noodler's Black's performance, though. Okay, this is what must have angered Confucius about the quality of the first inks. That's what he would have considered a weak ink. So, that's my experimentation with the earliest form of ink, which I do not, if you dig up formulas for this, I do not recommend it in this pen. It flows, but it flows reluctantly. And as you can see, with Noodler's Black, it's like a river onto the page. And with the ancient charcoal ink, it did not flow like this at all. It was very hesitant. And I would strongly recommend that use the ink that the pen was designed for. However, I have, if you want to experiment with this type of material, I recommend putting a marble in the bottle to agitate it. I recommend putting some shot in the pen to agitate it. And any other ink that has particulate matter that's pretty heavy, provided it's not so large that it can't even flow through the brush, this pen is more capable of handling it than previous pens that have been available. And it's two coffee cans. Two coffee cans. And bittersweet vine. Bittersweet vine is the vine that was surrounding Confucius north of the Yangtze River. This was the vine of his lessons. And this was the vine of the first ink that was based on charcoal. This is not a detailed medium. This is something that if you're... These are nice if you're working with a very large area. Detail work is relative. This could be the equivalent of a pencil with something, some piece of art that's 3 yards high. It's for smaller purpose items. I would suggest this is probably best used for water filtration. If it's not for something big, don't expect it to be for detailed work. Other than for shading, it is useful for shading in certain applications where you want to fill in areas. If you really need vine charcoal and somebody wants to charge you $7 or so for these segments, please remember that the best, the original, the one that was used by the ancient masters is growing all over the eastern United States. And is in fact such a pest that it's actually regulated as an invasive species in these areas. So I hope you found this at least interesting, and I hope you enjoy the brush pen, the Chinese style Ahab brush pen. And if you wind up making some charcoal for whatever reason, and you learned about it here, well, let me just say, the more of these you kill by finding a use for them, the better off the eastern United States will be. And doing it in the name of rediscovering the struggles that Confucius went through in order to make his ideas immortal is about the best reason one could possibly have for utilizing and cooking up such a plant. That's all.